Welcome to the Margaret J. Weber Distinguished Lecture Series here at the Graduate School of Education and Psychology at Pepperdine University. I am your host this evening, Dr. Helen Easterling Williams. It is my esteemed honor and such a privilege to share with you this evening. I tell you, as I lead the Graduate School of Education and Psychology, I find that my days are filled with exciting and often unexpected events. I meet such interesting people, and I am delighted to bring them to you, to share with you all the wonderful people that I meet in the community. Tonight, we have a special pleasure. The Margaret J. Weber Distinguished Lecture Series this year will actually have three different installments. Tonight, you will hear from a young lady that has just blown my mind. How could that happen, Dean? How could that happen? Well, I'll tell you in just a few moments, but first I want you to know that we would very much like for everyone to please mute your Zoom session, mute yourself, so that we all can enjoy the evening in the same manner. We don't want to be disturbed by any unexpected sounds. So please mute your iPad, your iPhone, your device, whatever you're using. If you have a question during the presentation, please enter that question into the chat. We will be sure to address it later, I guarantee. Now, during the Q&A, which will happen after our presentation, make sure you raise your hand. Use the feature that's provided and raise your hand and wait to be called upon, okay? Thank you so much for attending to that. That will help us have a wonderful evening. And now, if you will join me in a word of prayer. Pepperdine is a faith-based institution, and we do believe in covering all that we do in prayer, after which I will share a little bit with you about this fascinating lady that I met one day. So let us pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, we come before you this evening with such joy in our hearts, with great expectation and great anticipation, knowing, God, that you always delight in your children finding peace, finding joy, finding the golden nuggets that you leave for us. We pray that you will be with us this evening, that you will bless our conversation. May it be glorious in your sight. We pray a special blessing upon our presenter, O God. Give her calmness of spirit, glibness of tongue, God. Just cause her to shine, that your glory may be revealed unto us. Have her share nuggets, God, that will open the eyes of our participants, that we might be stronger and better and wiser for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And now, ladies and gentlemen, this is the moment you've been waiting for, because yeah. I tell you, my friend is a very special lady. How indeed did a woman with degrees in social work and psychology end up as a business startup authority, an organizational turnaround guru, and a chief marketing officer for a commercial spaceflight company? We're going to find out tonight. We're going to find out. I present to you Sandy Heydt. She is the founder and CEO of Heydt Marketing and Development, as well as an advisor at Space Perspective. She will share her non-traditional journey through life. She will discuss the challenges and the achievements of her career. She will share with us how fear and fearlessness impacts your life as you go day by day from experience to experience. She will help us to know how she has managed both fear and fearlessness and how she has come to this point. I met Sandy and my attention was drawn to her in such a way that I knew there was something special about this lady. I mean, Elon Musk goes to the edge of space, right? Richard Branson goes to the edge of space. That is something set aside for the one in a million individual, right? But Sandy convinces people to allow them to be placed in a capsule of sorts and taken to the edge of space and spend, not just go and touch the edge of space, but to actually spend time just existing in space. You've got to be really special to be able to convince someone to pay you for that experience. I've broken bread with Sandy, and I found her to be much more than that. Much more than that. I give you now, my friend, Sandy Heydt. Sandy, take it away. It's all yours.
Wow. Thank you, Dean Williams, for that lovely introduction.
My pleasure.
Receiving an introduction from Dean Williams is my honor. From the first moment I met her, it was clear to me that she is a living example of fearlessness in action. I am inspired by the person that Dean Williams is, as an individual and a professional woman. Clearly, the university is lucky to have her. The dean thought that my journey, personal, professional, and spiritual, would be of interest to you, as well as my philosophy of leadership. I am honored to share some thoughts with you today. Imagine a world where all leaders led with humanity. Imagine a world where every day, each of us approached our personal and professional lives with these four important elements: compassion, empathy, generosity, and courage. Just imagine how different our world and our experience in it would be. I see a world where this is possible, and I always have. I'd like to answer the question posed in the introduction to my talk. How did a woman with degrees in social work and psychology end up as a startup authority, an organizational turnaround guru, and a chief marketing officer for a spaceflight tourism company? My professional career has been a wild and exciting ride, I can tell you that, and it's not over yet. When I was growing up, I always imagined making a difference in people's lives. I was raised in a family of helping professionals, theologians, and educators. So I thought I would end up in one of those fields. But there was a different path waiting for me. My own spiritual journey has been interesting, as is my family's religious background, to say the least. My father's dad was a PhD theologian. The fascinating thing about my granddad is that he was half Jewish. He converted to Christianity in his teens, received his degrees, and was a minister, teacher, and author. He became the founder and first president of Lancaster Bible College in Pennsylvania. After retirement as a college president, he moved to New York City and worked with the Jewish community to bring the message of Jesus Christ to them. He was extremely passionate about this. My dad attended Lancaster Bible College. He met my mother there, the youngest child in a Mennonite family. She left the Mennonite church to marry my dad, causing her family to be shunned for a time by their community. After college, my dad became a high school teacher and tennis coach, but he felt called to the ministry. He looked at various theologies and found that Southern Baptist most matched his belief. So he went to a Southern Baptist seminary and became a minister. Once I was in college, he went on to be a hospital chaplain. This is the upbringing I remember. There is a lot to unpack here, right? But let me just say that everyone in this story was fearless. They were all passionate and went to great lengths to follow their own beliefs, even if it meant seriously bucking the system in which they were raised. I had my own creative spiritual journey, as you might imagine. As a preacher's kid, I had a lot of pressures on me. And the Southern Baptists had a lot of rules. But my parents did not like it when the church people told them how to raise their kids. Interestingly enough, my parents were strict about their theology, but not about the rules. Imagine this. The church pianist, me, walking to the front of the church as a teenager in my platform shoes, fishnet stockings, and short skirts. There was a lot of chatter about that, but my parents did not rein me in on the small stuff. However, I did get into quite a bit of trouble after drinking some cheap wine at my senior prom and trying to eat a camera sandwich. That was not good. My parents also encouraged the competitive athlete in me, which came to serve me well in my career. When I went to university, I rebelled as many preacher's kids do. I did not want anything to do with organized religion. This was my first fearless choice. Rejecting the theology of my upbringing meant rejecting the core of what my parents lived for. I adored them, and this was very difficult for all involved. I knew I was a spiritual person, and I'd find my way back to something meaningful for me. I had an amazing role model in my dad. He was compassionate, empathetic, non-judgmental, and kind. This is what I was looking for in spiritual teachings and practice. And it is what I found when I started studying Buddhism some 15 years later. The teachings resonated with me, and I liked that there was freedom in how Buddhism was practiced. This beautiful philosophy of living has stayed with me and become my spiritual and life practice. In fact, I am deepening my study and soon beginning a 2-year part-time program in Buddhist chaplaincy with a focus on social justice. I suppose I am a chip off the old blocks after all. As I moved through life, I was fearless like my parents and grandfather, willing to think for myself and make decisions that supported my passion and how I wanted to live my life. In my dad, I saw every day how he brought kindness and a sense of compassion to his job and interactions with others. I wanted to be like this. My dad was my first mentor. You can find your own mentor, and you should. This is important to your own personal and professional development. If there is someone you admire, just go ask them. They will probably say yes. During this talk, I will use examples of leadership in the business world, but I know every single one of you listening today, whether you will embark on a leadership role managing people and teams, become an educator, or plan to help clients as a therapist, you will be a leader. If you help people, clients, patients, employees, or students to make decisions about their own life and help them live their best and most meaningful existence, you are a leader. I clearly see the trajectory of my career path, and as unconventional as it sounds, it all makes sense to me. It all happened because I was fearless. I was not afraid of walking through doors that were cracked open for me, believing in myself and in what others said they saw in me. Being fearless means you don't harbor thoughts of self-doubt for long, and I challenge you all to do the same. This is only distracting and gets in the way. So take that cracked open door and kick it wide open. I attended Temple University and received my bachelor's degree in social work and went straight to a master's program in counseling psychology. I was planning to eventually get my PhD and hang up my shingle as a therapist. After receiving my graduate degree, I faced my next fearless choice: to move overseas for a year. I moved to Germany, where I taught psychology at the American High School and at the college level, and served as a high school guidance counselor. Then I moved back to the US to a few different cities and got jobs counseling kids and families. I started the application process for a PhD. I was only 24 years old. Something in me felt that I was too young to make such a big commitment. And even though I had experienced a lot, and perhaps because I had, I knew there was so much more out there to explore. I decided to look at the world outside my window. I decided to informational interview outside my field. I ended up in a small for-profit company that managed nonprofit organizations. I was the third employee, my first startup. This was my next fearless decision, leaving my field and trying something new in a city in which I had just moved. Luckily, this first business owner I worked with was a good teacher and a wonderful mentor. He believed in and supported his team. I call this experience getting my on-the-job MBA. And I never looked back. One early takeaway here is that once you make one fearless decision, you get more comfortable to make the next one. There is a shift in your brain and in your heart. You start to think then you could make more fearless decisions and you won't fail. You start to believe in your intuition, your ability to learn new things, and in your decisions. The confidence that comes with this just feeds on itself. And you can start to control the negative thinking in your head. You know those negative thoughts I'm talking about. The negative tapes. I'm not good enough. I'm not smart enough. He or she is better than me. I can't do that. Your brain just takes over and these tapes become stronger and very embedded. It takes some real effort to turn negative thinking into positive thinking. I did it, and I challenge you to do it as well. In my work, I kept honing my skills, learning from smart people, and finding great mentors. Back then, I don't think I paid much attention to the type of manager I was. I was young, competitive, and I wanted to succeed. I never had a business course in my life, nor did I study management or leadership. But I do know that I brought my helping professional self to the business world, along with my competitive drive and thirst for knowledge, and the fact that I wanted to be a great leader. How did this manifest itself? I was interested in the happiness and success of others. I wanted to work with teams that produced good work, and I knew that meant positive collaboration. I knew I did not want to be a jerk. Somehow, this approach worked because I continued to be promoted, became a vice president, and was leading teams at the age of 27. Here's my next fearless decision. A sibling was in distress, so I decided not only to move to a new city to be close to my sibling, but also change careers and take a hospitality position. This family-motivated move turned out to be one of the best career decisions I ever made, because in hotel sales and marketing, I found my home. Here's another lesson about fearlessness for you. Once you learn something new and even get a bit of external reinforcement for that, it spurs you on to believe you can move on and do anything. This is the point in my career where I learned what I was good at, my core skills and talents, and realized that these were transferable to multiple business types. I just had to articulate this, show examples, and talk somebody into hiring me. A person's fearlessness is evident to others. And if you believe you can do something, many times others will believe it too. I know that many positions I have had through the years came through because the CEO saw my tenacity, fearlessness, grit, and belief in myself. Who was I at the core? What is at your core? Well, that is what comes naturally to us. It is what others do not need to teach us. We have it already. This is our sweet spot. And if you can find a profession where your natural talents are necessary for success, you will certainly get there. It's like floating down a gentle stream rather than pushing against tough currents. I have a book to recommend about this concept. It is called First Break All the Rules by Marcus Buckingham and Kurt Kaufman. I refer to it all the time. It talks about natural talents and skills and brilliantly gives examples about how knowing this about yourself and others yields success in business and life. For the next 30 plus years, I was mostly working with hotels and resorts. I continued to talk myself into positions I had never done before. And once in these positions, I continued to work hard and succeed. I learned and learned and learned, not only about business, but about leadership and leading with humanity. During this time, I made another fearless decision. After working as an employee at hotels for about 11 years, I made the decision to start my own marketing firm and chart my own course. taking my leadership philosophy to a new level. I was going to take it to the open market without the safety net of being an employee. This was seriously scary. Fast forward 10 years later, and I had 27 other consultants working with me and assisted over 300 in hotels and resorts all over the world. I sold this business and it remains successful today. By now, I was much more conscious about why I was successful and what my prescription for success was all about. My particular field in the hospitality business was sales and marketing. During this 10-year run as a consultant, I became well known for go-to-market plans for new startup hotels and for working with hotels which were underperforming. Hotel owners and management companies would ask me to perform an assessment of what might be wrong and how they could fix it. It never took me long to figure out the problem, and usually it was something around the culture. Ineffective leaders who were not getting the best from their teams, to poor teamwork, and organizations that generally were not functioning efficiently. I laid out a roadmap, and then the client would hire me and my team to come in to implement my plan for the turnaround. I was in heaven. I became a change agent. This is another example of fearlessness. Running your own company, not being exactly sure where the next client was coming from, and being responsible for the livelihood of myself and others. Wow. Even though my ultimate task was revenue generation for my clients, a generally stressful job, I never lost sight that the greatest asset any company has is its human capital. I began to understand that if I focused on the individual and teams and the big four, compassion, empathy, generosity, and courage, the culture would improve and the results would come. In essence, I focused on people first and the results second. The revenue came every single time. How amazing. Sandy Heydt as a problem solver, change agent, and revenue producer, alongside CEOs and business owners from all over the world. That was where living and leading with fearlessness brought me. I led with compassion, empathy, generosity, and courage, and believe these are essential, non-negotiable qualities of a leader. And this is my core message to you today. Number one, compassion. The qualities of compassion are patience and wisdom, kindness and perseverance, warmth and sensitivity. A leader who leads with compassion looks at their team members as human beings first, employees second. Looking at things from a compassionate viewpoint brings attention to the humanity of a person. What makes them tick? What is important to them? And what is going on with them as a whole person? Do this, and someone will go to the ends of the earth to make you successful. Number two, empathy. A close cousin to compassion. Empathy is defined as the ability to sense other people's emotion, coupled with the ability to imagine what someone else might be thinking or feeling. This is putting yourself in somebody else's shoes. Empathy is the ability to recognize and understand another person or another group's experience. It's about understanding someone else's viewpoint and responding to them with their perspective in mind. I can't imagine a better quality of a leader. I have an amazing practice tool for you if you are having a challenging time feeling empathy for anyone in your life. I can ask Pepperdine to send this out to everyone who is on the talk tonight, along with some other resources that I recommend. Number three, generosity. Generous leaders have a willingness to give of their time, their energy, and their support. Generosity in the workplace includes kindness and open-handedness. There is freedom from meanness or smallness of mind. Generous leaders teach these traits to their team members and encourage the same from them. Even in a competitive sales environment in which I worked, generosity of spirit from leader to team and between team members is possible and critical. It creates a positive culture and amazing results. Number four, courage. The courageous leader stands up for the employee and their team. They stand up for the process they know works. They have tested their leadership and team building philosophy and know it yields positive results. The courageous leader stands up for what is right. This means that if your boss wants to force you to make a decision about your team or employee that you do not agree with, you push back. You make your case. You are not afraid to stand up for what is right and true. When situations call for honesty, compassion, or respect, the courageous leader weighs the options of decisions and acts appropriately and encourages their team to as well. Why is fearlessness necessary to lead with the big four? Or as some say, with humanity, with a soft edge. Because sometimes this takes more time and effort. It certainly takes a lot of emotional energy. But for me, this was worth it because I knew that focus on the individual first yielded an improved bottom line later. The hard edge is managing only by the numbers and results. We know that time, money, production, and results are important, but these things don't have to be the driving force of how individuals are related to or managed. I found the hard edge just sucks the joy right out of the job, puts people on edge, and has a negative effect on results. Don't be this person. Examples of this leadership style are telling people what to do, but not why, not giving clear directions or tools, and then berating people for not meeting objectives, not allowing people to bring their own creativity to the process, and causing team members to be on edge by using negative reinforcement. Basically, I call this type of leader the pounder. Don't be this person. People and teams can produce results in this negative environment, but the results are often short-lived. There is increased turnover, decreased productivity, and distrust by those who remain on the job. I have seen this time and time again. People cannot produce long-term from fear and intimidation, and they are not loyal to the leader, not at all. When I was an employee inside in an organization and not a consultant, I had a tougher time managing with humanity if the CEO did not believe in this philosophy. This is where fearlessness came in once again. I had to stand my ground. I had to try to change the culture. Sometimes it worked and sometimes not. It is challenging to keep a supportive culture alive. You have to work on this every single day. Many forces will try to change your course and challenge you. You have to be aggressive and vigilant in working through challenges. Sometimes recalibrate and go back to the drawing board. Sometimes you have to make difficult choices, but stay the course. Strong and fearless leaders engage their critics and make themselves stronger. Weak leaders silence their critics, aggressively impose their will, and make themselves weaker. Never forget this. So here's my prescription for successful results. Always remember when I walk in the office every day to manage with the big four: compassion, empathy, generosity, and courage. Make sure I hire the best people. Give them the tools and the training that they need. Ensure their environment is one where they can thrive. Make sure I am clear about expectations and results, and then get out of their way. Hold them accountable, discipline and regroup when necessary, change out team members when necessary, and look in the mirror and check myself and ask others for any input about my leadership performance. People who lead with humanity are not wimps. They are fearless. The more of us who lead with humanity will weed out the pounders of the world. So let's do this. The next part of my story is another lesson in fearlessness. I was recruited to be the chief marketing officer of Space Perspective, one of the companies taking people to space. You heard that right. I simply could not believe it when I got that phone call. I said yes. In just 7 months, our division exceeded ticket sales and revenue goals and enabled the company to go to a very important round A financing 6 months before projections. This was amazing on all accounts. So a little bit about this. We sold over 500 tickets at $125,000 each. This is a beautiful 6-hour experience. It's not a rocket, taking you up to space at 12 miles an hour in a pressurized capsule that holds 8 people, propelled by a space balloon the size of a football field. You can walk on the capsule in your shirt sleeves and enjoy food, beverage, Wi-Fi, and even a bathroom. This allows more people the opportunity to experience only what astronauts have, which is the profound and life-changing experience of seeing Earth from space and realizing that we are all one human family. I have moved out of this full-time position while continuing to support this amazing company in an advisory role so that I can be free to run my own consulting business again. Can you believe a new client of mine is a flying car company? Seriously, I cannot make this stuff up. So let's leave this wonderful gathering today with this thought. Be fearless. Make a decision today about the type of leader and person you are going to be. And take a cue from the fearless leadership of Jesus Christ and many others that walked this earth. Nelson Mandela, Gandhi, Desmond Tutu, Mother Teresa. You never know where life will take you. Thank you so much for listening to me and letting me share my story.
Thank you, Sandy. Wow. Let's give Sandy a warm GSEP congratulations. That was awesome. Oh my goodness, there was so much in that. It was packed. I thought I knew you. I thought I knew you. As I'm sharing, I'm hoping everyone will raise their hand and have questions ready for Sandy. We're going to go into a Q&A session. But Sandy, I thought I knew you. And I did. But I am even more impressed now, because now I understand it's that humanity thing. You live and breathe that humanity thing. The big four, it's who you are. You have been doing that for so long. It was from your communication. It was taught to you early in life. You know, you were spoon-fed compassion, empathy, generosity, and courage. And you didn't even know it. And then one day you looked around and found these four gems that were you. And you're living out who you are. And all these wonderful opportunities are coming your way because you're ready for them, because you know who you are. And when you know who you are, your purpose comes into existing. So the whole notion of the pianist at church going, walking to the front of the church in platform shoes, fishnet stockings, and the short skirt, I'm screaming.
Yes, well, some people were screaming at my father.
But it all speaks to fearlessness, right? And as you said, it came from those around you that nurtured you. Everyone, you were blessed. But everyone isn't blessed with that kind of environment, that kind of nurturing, you know. Where would you suggest someone who wasn't raised in that environment, where would you suggest them to go to find that? How can they tap into that? Any thoughts about that? I'm checking
the chat. I do, because I think that you should go find a mentor, like I mentioned. If you know what you want to become, and you know that you have goals and achievements and the kind of person that you want to be, go find a mentor that can help you do it. And they will say yes. I can't believe how many times I have heard other people tell me about mentors they've had and the generosity of spirit that those mentors have shown them. And I think that anybody can do that if they believe in themselves. And it's also why I talked about the negative thinking. And we've all been there, all of us, no matter who we are. And it's a matter of starting to understand that we all can control the thinking in our own brains and how we believe in ourselves. And if we find mentors to help us and surround ourselves with people like us, who have the goals that we have, I think most anybody can achieve what they want to and overcome a lot of obstacles.
A mentor is key. I have found mentors in unusual moments, in unexpected places. Has that been the case for you?
Oh, very much so. I've found mentors in people that were on my team. You know, you hire people, you have a team of people, and all of a sudden there's somebody teaching you about generosity and kindness in the workplace. And I've learned from so many people. I think a lot of this has to do with humility. And I don't think that enough of us have been raised to think that humility is a positive way to be. But if we are humble, it opens us up to so many other things, to so many other people and things to learn and paths to go down, because our ego doesn't get in the way. That's another thing that I think is important.
I'm looking, thank you for that. I'm looking in the chat and I see, thank you, Vanessa, for putting the big four in the chat. I see Abigail Ramsey said, such a wonderful talk. Sandy, I want to share your words with everyone I can. What an interesting, what a wonderful comment. Someone else said, someone on iPhone, I don't have a name I can see here, says Sandy is the real deal. Thank you for sharing your incredible story. Have you thought of yourself as the real deal? And if so, when did that occur to you? I mean, what was it that pulled that out of you?
I think being courageous when leaders around me were managing in a way that I thought was negative, inappropriate, without compassion and empathy. Mm-hmm. And I just stood up for what I believed was right. And I think I made a number of people uncomfortable along the way. Uh-huh. I was not a pleaser. Certainly I had to do a lot of pleasing in my career, that's for sure. And I had a lot of goals that I had to reach for my clients and my employers. But I think when you're the real deal, you just say what's in your heart and what your truth is. And sometimes it's not popular, but again, if we can learn how to say these things with compassion, mm-hmm. people will hear us.
Yes, yes. Really good advice, really good. Charles Gross wants to know more about the empathy document that you spoke of earlier. Can you give us more insight on that, Sandy?
I can. I don't know how much time we have, but it was a training that I did in one of my companies with neuro-linguistic programming. I'm sure you've heard about that, some of you. And basically, everybody talks about, think about what the other person is feeling or put yourself in their shoes. And it's kind of easy to say, but this exercise is you take two pieces of paper, and on one piece of paper, you write your name, and on the other piece of paper, you write the person's name who you're having a struggle with. You put those pieces of paper about 6 feet apart. You put the name of that person, you stand on your own paper, and you look and pretend that you see the person that you're having a challenge with standing on their piece of paper. Mm. And you tell them why they're bugging you. What about them is not right. You just let loose. You just say you this and you that. You just say your truth about what's really bothering you. You get it all out. Then you walk over to their spot and turn around and look back at where you were standing, and you have to speak as that person.
Mm.
So you say how do you think you would feel just hearing that from someone, and try to think about what that person would be feeling and experiencing in their life if they're messing up, if they're not being right, whatever it is, try to think about how it feels to be them and say it out loud to where you were standing. Then come back to where you started.
Oh no, there's more. Oh my.
There's more. You come back to where you started and now you speak back to that person based on what you just heard. And you have to say it out loud. And sometimes you can keep going back and forth a couple of times. Mm-hmm. But if you really, really get into character and you really get in, it's like truly standing in that person's shoes. I'm telling you, it works for me every time.
Amazing.
You might want to practice it in small groups. That's how I learned it. And then there was an observer who gave us feedback on what we were doing.
I see.
There's something about saying things out loud versus thinking them. It becomes real. You can hear it. There's something about that auditory connection.
That is, okay, like I said, oh no, I have plenty of work to do. Plenty of work to do. There's always someone or something, it seems always. That's a pretty definite term, but there's generally someone or something in our lives that gets under our skin. And if we are not careful, we can self-destruct. This exercise that you have just shared with us has the potential to break that trend even before it really gets started. It seems to be a prescription that's very liberating.
You know what's very liberating? This is like just a really simple example. But you go to the coffee shop to get a cup of coffee in the morning, and the person that's waiting on you is rude. And what's your first reaction? You know, to sort of lash back at them because that wasn't nice or whatever? Or could your first reaction be killing them with kindness and thinking about, I wonder what their morning was like? I wonder if they got into a car accident. I wonder if their child woke up sick. I wonder, you know, and you know what? It just shifts, it shifts something. And I'm not saying that I do that all the time. I don't. But when I don't feel so good about myself.
Yeah.
Because when I am not having a particularly great day, I would certainly love it if somebody else showed me a little bit of empathy. So why can't I do it the other direction?
Wow. An exercise in empathy. Marvelous. Marvelous. This, Sandy, is truly Christ in action. This is a very tangible way that every one of us, no matter who we see as our spiritual leader, this is what we can do every day in every situation and find peace. Here at GSEP, we always say we operate with benevolent grace. We give more, you know, there's got to be a reason. We say that you have given us a tool to actualize that. What a marvelous gift you've given us tonight. The gift of your life's journey, the gift of the big four. I love it. I love it. The way you constantly shared with us nuggets and in a very directive yet passionate way, compassionate way, you said, find a mentor. Do not harbor thoughts of self-doubt. Ladies and gentlemen, let's put stars behind that one. Do not harbor thoughts of self-doubt. Control the negative thoughts in your head, the tapes that run seemingly automatically. Be interested in the happiness and success of others. Do not be a jerk. I especially like that one. Do not be a jerk. We have natural talents that are necessary for our success. And Sandy, you put it in such an eloquent way. You said something like flowing down a gentle stream. My goodness, the imagery in that. Flowing down a gentle stream. The highest asset that we have is human capital. And so it is not a strange thing to think that empathy, compassion, generosity, and courage would be at the center of all that you do. If the highest asset is human capital, we must take care of that. We must take care of that. The hard edge sucks the joy out of a job. So true. We often go for the numbers, but that's not where the true value lies. And then you said a bunch of other things, but you also said, engage the critic.
Mm-hmm.
And ask others to, I won't use the word criticize, but to give their opinions of you and how you are managing. How many of us don't ever do that? We're afraid of assessment. And that's because we are not operating with the big four. Sandy, you have enlightened us. The chat room is full of compliments and thank yous. And I should pick out one comment by Pat Moran, because Pat says, thank you for sharing your journey with us tonight. And I read this for everyone who is present. Thank you for sharing your journey with us tonight. Ever since I've known you, I marveled at how fearless you've always been in everything you've approached. Very inspiring. So this isn't new. You've been living this.
Well, that's what I want everybody to take away. If I can do it, anybody can do it.
Oh my.
And I really believe what I said, that once you make one fearless decision, the next one is easier to make. Mm. And the next one is easier to make because your self-confidence grows and you found mentors and you're learning, and it's sort of like it just keeps on going. So maybe the first time is the hardest, but keep on doing it and you'll see that it'll become your life story.
And we will let that nugget of insight be the final word for this evening. Thank you so much. Let's give Sandy another GSEP round of applause. Truly, this was wonderful that you shared with us. You've inspired us. You enlightened us. And I believe we will be better leaders because you have shown us Christ in action. I want to give a special thank you to all of you who attended tonight. I want to say a special hello to Marilyn Wright, a member of our board of visitors who is with us tonight. Thank you, Marilyn. And I want to say hello and thank you and welcome to Margaret Weber, Our distinguished lecture series is named after her. So ladies and gentlemen, would you please, let's have a round of applause for Margaret. Thank you for starting this, Margaret. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you so much. Thank you, Sandy. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I'll see you again soon so we can break bread once again.
You bet. Good night, everybody. Thank you, Dean Williams.
It is my great honor. Thank you, Vanessa. Vanessa John. Good night, everyone. Bye-bye.